In this video, we'll be talking about European VAT taxes. VAT is a tax which every European country adds whenever a purchase happens. So if you're an Amazon seller or e-commerce seller, you have to deal with different complex rules of VAT, and different countries have different VAT rates. If you're selling internationally, cross-border in Europe, also you have to follow certain rules and be compliant. And this is what this video will be about. And I invited Alex Wyatt from SimplyVAT. Hello, Alex.
Hello. Thanks for having me. Always a pleasure.
Yeah. Yes. And so SimplyVAT can help you with tax compliance in Europe. And I think you are expanding to other regions as well, right? We will have a short slide very soon about that. I think we can start with simply introducing the situation for Amazon sellers. What is VAT and where to be kind of where to look at and what to know, right? So I know that Alex has few slides prepared, so let's jump to them.
Perfect. Thanks, Augustus. So yeah, I've just prepared a few slides really to just set the scene on European VAT. There's a lot to take in as soon as you start trading cross-border. So I'm really going to try to simplify it during this next hour. So first off, why is it important to talk about VAT? First of all, it's a legal obligation to collect VAT where you've triggered it. So you do need to make sure that you are collecting VAT. It is important. There's two things certain in life, that's death and taxes. And so you do need to make sure that your business is being compliant. Next, you can save money by reclaiming purchase VAT or import VAT. So VAT is not supposed to be a burden to VAT registered businesses. So if you are importing with a VAT ID on your import documents, you can always reclaim that on your local VAT return. Next, it can actually be a barrier to signing up to marketplaces. Some marketplaces like Amazon will require you to VAT register before you even start selling. So you will need to make sure you get a VAT registration in place before you even sign up in certain circumstances. So make sure when you're signing up to enter into a new market, you're checking in advance, because you want to make sure that you're preparing to get these VAT registrations in place before you start trading. And finally, it's really there to help plan your pricing, strategy, market entry. It will give you a competitive advantage. And you really want to look at the timeline. So your pricing strategy, because you need to make sure you're accounting for VAT in the prices that you list on Amazon. It's going to be included in the price, much different to like trading in the US, where it's added at checkout. You want to make sure that you're keeping a competitive advantage with your pricing. You have to remember that VAT rates can change and range between 17% and 27%, depending on where your end customers are located. And you also want to take into consideration the timeline. So it can take anywhere between 2 weeks all the way up to 12 to 14 weeks to get a VAT registration in place, depending on where you're looking to get VAT registered. It's all country specific. So you want to make sure you're planning well in advance to getting that VAT registration. So what are the current rules for e-commerce businesses? So they've currently abolished the distance selling thresholds. These were old rules where you could sell cross-border up until set thresholds were met. These have been abolished. And what's been put in its place is an introduction of a single EU-wide exemption threshold, but this is only for EU-based businesses. So it's set at 10,000 euros. If you're an EU-based business and you're selling cross-border, you will have up until 10,000 euros until you have to start collecting VAT from the customers cross-border. Otherwise, if you are a non-EU business, you have to start collecting VAT from your very first transaction. VAT is going to be due where your end customers are located. For B2C supplies, so any individual private consumers, you're going to be charging the local rate of VAT where your end customers are based. There's the implementation of the Union Aus scheme, which is a simplification scheme that allows businesses to collect VAT and report from all different countries and report it on one single quarterly filing. So it's a huge simplification. It means you don't have to VAT register in every single member state you're selling goods into, which is fantastic. Marketplaces and platforms are deemed suppliers for specific transactions. So actually marketplaces are supposed to collect VAT on behalf of specific merchants. So if you're a non-EU business, marketplaces are going to collect this VAT for you. And we'll cover this in a few slides. And then there's also the introduction of the import one-stop shop scheme, which allows businesses to import directly to customers from outside of the EU to customers inside the EU under a super simple scheme as well that allows marketplaces to collect VAT on your behalf. So just going to cover off a few case scenarios here. So if you're importing to EU customers from the UK, the USA, or anywhere else in the world other than the EU, this is what you need to know. If they are low-value goods sold on Amazon, and when I talk about low-value goods, I mean anything less than 150 euros. And that's 150 euros in consignment value, and it's excluding any taxes, VAT. If you're sending these goods directly to customers in the EU and it's below that threshold, Amazon is actually going to take on the responsibility of VAT charging and collecting. So at the point of sale, Amazon is going to keep the local VAT rate percentage from your order and transaction, and they are actually going to remit that to the tax authorities on your behalf. What you need to do as a merchant is collect Amazon's IOS number, their import one-stop shop number, and put this on your shipping documents with your parcel, and that will go directly to the customer, and there will be no extra duties or your goods won't get stopped at the customs border. So this allows your goods for fast release through customs. For your goods above 150 euros in consignment value, it's going to be your responsibility as the seller to collect and remit that VAT. So VAT is going to be due at importation. You'll have to pay the local VAT rate, and then duties will also apply on your goods, and that is specific to your individual product. So keep in mind that consignment value if you're shipping from the UK, USA, or anywhere else in the world directly to EU customers. And if it's less than 150 euros, make sure you're grabbing Amazon's IOS number. Next, we're going to look at goods stored in Amazon FBA warehouses. So let's quickly look at the different types of FBA solutions for you. First off, we have the EFN network. That's the European Fulfillment Network. It's a really great one to start off your business in if you're entering into the EU market. It means that you're holding goods in one EU country and then selling cross-border to multiple different EU member states from there. Next, we have the multi-country inventory scheme. This is where you choose which countries you'd like to dispatch from in the EU. So you can choose from any which fulfillment centers that Amazon has available in the various different countries. And you can pick and choose, maybe dependent where your customers are located. If you want to, if you know Germany is a great market for your products and you just want to be close to your customers in Germany and not hold your stock in all these different EU member states, maybe you'll just be choosing the multi-country inventory for countries where your customers are located. Next, we have the pan-EU scheme. This is where you will import your goods into one of these EU member states, and Amazon will actually take control of your products and move them amongst the various different warehouses. So that's Germany, France, Italy, Spain, Czech Republic, and Poland. And you can also add other countries in there, such as Sweden and Netherlands, which are new countries to Amazon's FBA centers. And finally, we have the Central European scheme where you pay less for fulfillment when using Germany, Czech Republic, and Poland in combination. So you're paying less than, say, the EFN network where you're just shipping from one country, but maybe slightly more than the Pan-EU network where Amazon has full control of your inventory. So once you choose your FBA setup where you want to be holding your inventory, then we need to look at your VAT obligations. So you're going to require a VAT registration in the country where you're holding stock. So depending on where you're, which setup that you have chosen, you need to make sure you have that local VAT registration in place. Once your VAT registration is in place, you can reclaim your import VAT on your local VAT return. You must record sales made on your VAT return. So no matter what happens from our next slide, you need to make sure that you're recording all of your VAT all of your transactions on your VAT return. And finally, you must declare any stock movements between EU member states. So if you're using something like the Pan-EU scheme or the multi-country inventory or even the Central European schemes, then you will have to make sure that you are declaring your cross-border movements of goods on a local EC sales list. Where is your business based? So this is going to depend on how the VAT is treated when you're selling on Amazon. So if you're an EU-based business, you're going to include VAT in your product listings, in that price. You're going to register for the Union OS scheme in your home country, and you're going to collect and remit all the sales VAT to the relevant tax authority on your Union OS scheme report. And that's a quarterly report, as I mentioned before. So as an EU-based business, for your Amazon transaction, you are responsible to collect and remit the VAT to the tax authorities yourself. The big difference here between non-EU-based businesses, and this is including UK businesses, is that UK, or these non-EU businesses will include the VAT in your product listings, in your prices, but Amazon is going to collect the VAT and pay this over to the tax authorities. You must still report this as an exempt VAT transaction on your local return. So you still need that local VAT return, but this time you're going to be recording it as exempt VAT, and Amazon will be moving the VAT collected from the transaction to the tax authority, and the tax authorities will handle the money themselves. So where can SimplyVAT help? So we help with the union and non-union OS registrations, the IOS registrations, any EU VAT compliance like these local registrations, any consultancies and VAT rate reviews as well, just in case you don't know what VAT rate your product should be. So that is where we can help, and I'm happy to answer any questions that might come about.
And yeah, here are your contacts. Also, you will find below in the description the link to SimplyVAT if you want to contact them. Mention us, and they will give additional attention, I hope. And Alex, you not only help with European taxes, VAT, you also start helping soon with taxes in Canada and other countries. Is it correct?
Correct. Yeah, we definitely help already in Canada. So if you're selling in Canada at the moment, that's definitely something that we can assist you with. And then also if you're selling into Australia, Norway, I know Switzerland is a new one that's coming up on Amazon's radar. Those are other countries that we can assist with as well.
Perfect. So, Canada and like US, maybe a lot of people from US might be watching this video and they understand the sales tax. Can you give us a difference between sales tax in North America and VAT in Europe?
Of course. Yeah, it's a really good question. So sales tax, let's start with the very basics. The VAT and sales tax are similar at its core. However, how it's treated is very differently. So sales tax in the United States is added at the checkout. So you'll see a price listed maybe for $9.99, and then the local sales tax is going to be added on top. And that sales tax is going to be based on which state you're in, which county you're in. It can even be which postcode that you're down to. The sales taxes are going to fluctuate based on where you are purchasing from. Now, VAT, it is a value-added tax. So it's added at every step of the supply chain for any businesses trading in Europe under the using VAT. But the big difference here is that it's included in your price and it's going to always be reclaimable if you're VAT registered. So like I mentioned before, it's not supposed to be a burden to VAT registered businesses. You can reclaim that on your local VAT return. But that big difference is really that it's included in the price listed. So if I go to a shop down the road here in the UK, I can see that the price that says maybe $9.99, that's already including the 20% VAT rate. It's not added later down the line. So what I see is what I pay, and you have to make sure that you are handling that in your prices when you're selling on Amazon in Europe.
Mnasov wants to know, can you recommend some tools that can help to manage VAT on Amazon?
Yeah, of course. I guess it depends on what you're looking for. Now, I know Amazon has a specific thing called the Amazon VAT calculation services. Now, the VAT calculation services actually create invoices for your business. It allows you to sell to businesses on Amazon as well, if that's something that you're, if that's like a target audience for your products. So that will help you create those invoices that might be mandatory in the specific EU member states. And then I guess it depends on what you mean by managing. So if it's managing the actual reporting, there's definitely services out there such as SimplyVAT that are able to help you actually collect the, all of your transactional data, report that on a quarterly, monthly, whatever that frequent filing frequency is, and let you know how much VAT is owed, where to pay it, and make sure that it's filed on time to the tax authorities.
And VAT is so complex that there is no software, or nobody can provide a software which is automated, and there is no interaction from a human. I guess like always when you file reports, there are some, like a human needs to double check if all the numbers are correct before they send the documents to authorities, right?
Yeah, I think the number one thing is that you will find there are SaaS solutions, like Amazon itself even does say that it offers a VAT solution. But the biggest problem there is that if you have questions, you won't be able to get answers directly from a human. And I think that's the number one grievance that we've hear from our customers, is that especially Amazon, as I know many people are aware, how Amazon treats sellers, where you can't really get through to anyone and it's hard to get an answer. And now this comes down to your business. And if you owe taxes, or if there's a problem with your taxes, you want to make sure that you can communicate with the tax authority. You don't want to be solving that by yourself in a foreign language. So that's just something to consider. You know, if you're planning on using Amazon, you might not have that handheld service that you would get elsewhere, like at SimplyVAT.
Perfect. Yanis would like to get more explanation about taxes in Canada. Yeah, actually, Alex is coming from Canada, right, yourself, right?
I am coming from Canada, yeah. And I know Janice, so good to see you on here, Janice. Taxes in Canada. So I'll give you a brief overview, and I know it's something that Augustus and I want to talk about more on another webinar, so hopefully you can tune into that one as well. But a brief overview for the Canadian taxes. So they are slightly different to VAT, but they follow really similar principles to VAT and a little bit from the US as well. So I'll give you some changes here. So let's go through. First off, there's GST, which is the goods and services tax. Then we have PST, which is the provincial sales tax. And we have HST, which is the harmonized sales tax. The harmonized sales tax actually takes PST and GST, puts it into one single tax rate, and allows you to file it on the GST return, so a single return. So in some provinces, depending on where you're trading, where you're holding your goods, some provinces will have GST and PST, and they're going to be separate returns. Some provinces, like Alberta, will only have GST, so you only have one return to file there, or on your general GST return. And some, like Ontario, have harmonized sales tax, so you're filing all of your PST and GST all on one single return. So that's one thing just to get out of the way, is that you'll hear the terms GST, PST, HST, and they're just meaning different types of filing and different VAT. Tax rates. When we look at GST, it is a standard 5% across all of Canada. So your GST rate, no matter what, will be 5%. Then we have PST, and that, like I said, is provincial specific. So it depends, again, on the province that you're looking at. There'll be Quebec, for example, will have their own rate. It's called QST. And then British Columbia, for example, will also have their own provincial sales tax rate. When we go into HST, that harmonized sales tax, like I mentioned, you are actually combining the HST and the PST together to make that one single one. So in Ontario, you have your 5% GST and 8% PST, and that's all combined to 13%. HST. So all your recording is HST at 13% in Ontario on your GST return. Slightly complicated. I would love to do it again with more slides and so I can visualize it. But I'm hoping that's kind of demystified the taxes there for you, Janice. And yeah, happy to answer more questions, especially on another webinar where I can go into more detail.
And Nassuf, who was asking about VAT and managing tools, what is your pricing to manage VAT, collect reports, etc., on European marketplaces? They are based in France and selling in France, Germany, Italy, Spain.
Perfect. So I don't know if I can give you a quote right off the top of my head here, but because you're a French business, you don't need any fiscal representation. And we don't do local VAT for local businesses. So say, because you're a French business, we wouldn't do your French VAT. That would be handled by your local accountancy firms. However, we would do that international taxes. So Germany, Italy, Spain, we can do the VAT registrations for you and then the ongoing compliance. So in Germany, it would be monthly, and Italy and Spain quarterly, plus an annual return in each of those countries. So happy if you can send me an email and I can give you a quote, because I just can't tell you off the top of my head at the moment.
Perfect. Next question is from Zain. When should we hire an accountant if we plan to launch in the French market, once we start selling or once a financial year ends?
Good question. So, I want to kind of stress the difference between the accountants and us as, say, a tax agent. Accountancy firms are looking after kind of your bookkeeping, all of your local, like, income taxes, corporation taxes. So accountants are really great at all that, everything in the country where you're established. And then for us as an international tax agent, we work alongside accountancy firms to handle all of the international VAT reporting. And the VAT is specific because it's just on the sales that you're having. So there's no corporation tax due when you're selling abroad, no income tax due when you're selling abroad, just physical goods. So we would work with your accountant. So when should you hire an accountant if you plan to launch in the French market? You don't necessarily need an accountant if you're not based in France. Typically, accountancy firms don't understand the international obligations. Like I said, they're used to doing the local accountancy work. if you wanted to look into hiring someone like a tax agent, an international tax agent, someone like us, for the French market, it's currently taking about 12 weeks to get a VAT registration, so about 3 months. So you want to make sure that you are accounting for that time, that processing time with the tax authorities. So really giving yourself loads of time in advance. If you know that you want to start selling in February, for example, the best time to start the application would be now, because you'd have to fill out the documents and then make sure that goes off to the tax authorities and you have your number before you import your goods. Hopefully that answers your question, Zane, but happy to answer any more.
Perfect. Marco talks about North Island. So they ship goods from North Island to UK fulfillment centers to use EFN scheme. Do Amazon collect VAT from our selling price, or do we continue to report this in North Island? We sell FBM.
Okay, so this would be dependent also on where your business is based, Marco, for the UK specifically.
Maybe it's in North Island.
If it's Northern Ireland, so Amazon wouldn't collect UK VAT for UK-based businesses. That would be down to UK businesses to handle. Amazon would collect it for non-UK businesses trading within the UK. However, you do need to have your local UK VAT registration as a non-EU business holding goods in the UK or Northern Ireland. It's just a slightly different number, the XI number. But you'd always need to, what's important is you need to make sure when you're setting your prices on Amazon that it's including the VAT, and then Amazon will deduct, if Amazon's collecting it, Amazon will deduct it from that gross price that you listed on your listing. So you have to keep that in mind, that Amazon's going to take that away from you. They're going to keep that, say, in escrow, and they'll pay it themselves if that's their responsibility. Otherwise, they'll take their commission and then give you the rest. And if it's your responsibility, then you have to pay that. But that, Marco, comes down to where your business is based in the case for UK. And I apologize for not covering that off in my slides.
All right. Chloe Wright says, if we apply the Incoterms throughout Europe and UK, do we have to apply VAT as per the new VAT calculation post-Brexit?
It depends on which Incoterm you're using. So the Incoterms, what Chloe is talking about is probably something like DAP, delivered at place, or DDP, deliver duty paid. And that all, the Incoterms really specify how goods are being imported and who is the importer, essentially. Who's responsible for paying the import taxes and duties as the goods clear through customs. So, it depends which Incoterm that you use. Do you have to apply VAT as per the new VAT calculation? So if you are using something like the DDP Incoterms, where you, the seller, are going to be the importer of record, you're going to be the one paying the duties and taxes in advance, then you would use your EORI number on the import documents. Your EORI number is your import number. It identifies you as the importer. And if, again, it depends on if we're talking about Amazon specifically here, you'd use Amazon's IOS number for anything going below 150 euros, anything above 150 euros, you would be responsible. And like I said, use your EORI. If you're selling through your own website, in this case, you'd be responsible both ways. If it goes below 150 euros, you can choose to register for the IOS scheme. That's a great scheme that's helping businesses trade cross-border into the UK without the goods stopping at customs, and there's no extra charges and hidden fees for your end customers as well. So the IOS scheme is really beneficial for many businesses. You have to use the DDP Incoterms though. If you're using DAP, it's going to mean that your customers are responsible for the import documents and, or sorry, the import VAT. And I'm just seeing Chloe's next message. And if the customer is responsible, your goods won't be able to go past customs without having that VAT and duties paid as the goods clear through. So you need to make sure that the customers are super aware if that's going through your own website, that they're aware that the goods are going to have extra fees as they clear through, and they won't be cleared through without it. So you could have a bad customer experience on your hand.
So yeah, she asked Incoterm DDP, if we are transparent with the tax authority from demand to supply.
Yeah, so if you're using DDP, I would say, it depends on which website you're selling on, which platform. If it's your own website and the goods are less than 150 euros, 100% use the IOS scheme. That's definitely going to help you import your goods. If you are selling on Amazon, use their IOS number. Amazon is responsible to collect the VAT and remit that to the tax authorities for anything being imported directly to customers less than 150 euros that's sold on Amazon. So you would use the DDP Incoterm and use Amazon's IOS number, and they'll provide this to you in Seller Central. So you can take that, use their IOS number on Amazon transactions, use your own IOS number for your own website transactions.
Perfect. So, Dr. Watson, thank you very much for your answers. I wanted to, did you see your new label below you? Dr. Watson.
Is it correct? I see that.
So I wanted to mention, like, if you need help with VAT compliance in Europe, in Canada as well, with the taxes, check the link below for a SimplyVAT service. Alex is representing this company. They can help to be compliant, and they can advise you about pricing and offer and everything else. And I see Zane is asking, wants help from Dr. Watson. Actually, he was asking about French accountants or French compliance.
Okay.
So he does have French company established to get exempted from government revenue tax. I know I won't be exempted from Amazon charging me VAT unless I register VAT with the government. Is it correct?
Correct. Yeah. So Amazon is actually going to charge you VAT as if you're not VAT registered as a business in France, then Amazon is going to charge you as if you were a customer, a private individual. So like I mentioned before, as a VAT registered business, you can always reclaim your purchase VAT or your import VAT on your local VAT return. There's also specific rules in the EU. So as a French business, if you had a French VAT number and Amazon was trying to charge you French VAT, there would also be the domestic reverse charge mechanism available. There's a reverse charge mechanism available, which essentially zeroes out your tax obligation, because it says that you don't need to pay it and reclaim it. It's just going to be zeroed out on your invoice. So there's different rules, again, dependent on what's Amazon actually charging you for. So if it's fulfillment charges, that might be different to PPC charges. So there, Amazon could charge you different ways. Most of those are going to be reclaimable for you as a VAT registered business. But if you're not VAT registered, Zane, then unfortunately you can't reclaim any of that. So that's a shame. Obviously, it's money gone. Poof. Mm-hmm. So definitely, yeah, if you're going to be trading at least over that 10,000 euro threshold, it's definitely worth getting VAT registered. And if you're selling cross-border, then make sure you're getting a Union OS registration as well, because Amazon won't collect the taxes on your behalf.
Perfect. And I see a lot of people, they're thankful for the answers. Chloe says, thank you. Nasuf is happy. And Alison says, thank you, very informative. And if you like the video, if you enjoy the content and you get useful advice, please don't forget to like and, of course, subscribe. And if you're watching a recording, leave your additional questions in the comment section below so that we can ask Alex to respond to them later. And I have a few more questions. So you mentioned at the very beginning about new countries, Sweden, Netherlands in Europe. Are these countries included in PAN-EU program?
So from what I've seen on Amazon is that you can add them into the PAN-EU program. So the traditional PAN-EU program is those kind of six core EU countries plus the UK now that we've left the EU. But you can add in, like I mentioned before, the multi-country inventory. You can kind of add in these other marketplaces as well, Sweden and Netherlands. We've started to see some of our clients actually, their stock is going into those other EU member states as well, so that they're closer to the customers. I haven't seen that there's been a massive uptake in Sweden. It hasn't been a huge kind of expansion into Sweden yet, but I'm sure it will do over time as it gets momentum. And same thing with the Netherlands, it's kind of a slow burn. We haven't seen loads of requests for it, but it's kind of, I guess, chicken or the egg. When is it going to start booming?
Perfect. And are there any items which are not subject to VAT if you're selling on Amazon?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually. So if it depends on which country you're selling into, that's the first thing. And it will depend on which product. So for example, in the UK, there's specific items that are zero rated, and you can apply for an exemption of VAT if you're only selling these products. So these are things like children's goods, like children's clothing, for example. It could be safety things like helmets. It can be specific food items as well. They can be reduced rated, for example. So it would really be dependent on those products in that country. Now, the UK and Ireland are the only two countries that have zero rated VAT products. So any other country wouldn't have that. So you need to make sure they may have a reduced rated VAT rate in that specific country, but it might not be a zero rate because they might not have it in that specific country. So I think that really kind of links into when you're selling cross-border, like I mentioned in the presentation, your VAT is going to be charged where your end customer is. So whether you have zero rated VAT, say you're selling children's clothes in the UK and in Germany and in France and in Italy. Now in the UK, if you set your price excluding taxes, that's great, but make sure when you're setting your price on amazon.de.fr.it that you are bumping up your price to include VAT, because like I mentioned, they don't have those zero VAT rates, and it's just going to be eating out of your margins, because across, you know, Germany and Italy and France and Spain, it can range from 19% to 22%, depending on that country. So that's a huge amount of your margin that you could be losing out on, just because you forgot to add in your VAT into your product prices that you list on Amazon.
And you said you have to apply. Let's say someone is selling just children helmets for the bikes.
Yeah.
In UK, so they shouldn't, if it's tax or VAT exempt, it doesn't mean that they shouldn't register and shouldn't get like a reports filing, right?
Correct. You still have that obligation. If you've triggered the VAT registration, say you're holding inventory as a non-UK business, you still have to get VAT registered in the UK. Now, as you get registered, if you know that you're only going to be applying, zero rates to all of your items, and essentially you're going to be filing what we call nil returns, so nothing on the return each month, then you can apply for a VAT exemption. So where you say, these are my products, this is why I don't need the VAT registration as in whole, and HMRC will come back and say, okay, you get the exemption. They'll give you a letter, and you can give that to Amazon as well so that they know mm-hmm. that you don't have to.
But if in addition to like children items you are selling water bottles and you need to account UK VAT for water bottles, you still can sell other products with zero VAT, just you will need to file taxes according to the rules.
Exactly. So if you're selling helmets and water bottles, the helmets would be zero VAT, mm-hmm. and just in the UK, for example. So you wouldn't include the VAT in your prices because it's not necessary, but your water bottles would require it. So in your prices, when you're setting your prices, you would include the 20% VAT for those water bottles, but not for the helmets. And then when it comes to reporting the VAT on your VAT return to HMRC, you would say in your gross total, you would include all of your transactions, even the zero VAT transactions. When it comes to a separate box on your VAT return where it states how much VAT is collected, you would put in the VAT. And then there's also a separate line for the exempt items as well, or the zero VAT rates. So everything will be mapped out on your local VAT return.
Thank you. Perfect. Can you give advice for a US-based company who wants, you know, an easy entrance to European marketplace with, of course, they have to be tax compliant, but tax compliance means additional expense, paying, like, say, a service like yourself. What would be your advice to minimize the cost of tax compliance because they want to enter just to see how it works and if it's worth for them to expand?
Yeah, so this is also a really good question. So if you're a US company wanting to trade, coming on over, I always like to say, start with the English-speaking countries because obviously it's the same language, like even less barriers to entry than having to localize all of your listings for Germany and France and Italy, etc. So definitely I would say start in the UK. It's not the biggest market anymore post-Brexit. Germany is the biggest market in Europe. However, it is the second biggest market. So it is still a huge opportunity for businesses. If you wanted to keep your VAT to apps like expenses to nothing, and your prices are less than £135 or less than €150 in consignment value, then I would suggest, if you really wanted to put no kind of money into it, I suggest shipping it from the US directly to the UK. Now your shipping costs are going to be higher, and so you might not get as many purchases, but if you really wanted to keep it to nothing, ship it from the USA directly to customers in UK or Europe, because you can use Amazon's IOS number, and there's a special kind of way to get it into the UK for marketplace sales as well under £135. And that means you don't need to have any VAT registrations at all. Like I mentioned, though, you might not get as many transactions because of the higher shipping costs and how long it might take to ship from the USA. If you wanted to go in lower cost, the next best case scenario would probably be moving your goods into the UK directly. Like I mentioned, it's a cheaper country to go into in terms of language and the setup costs. Who knows, some people might even be benefiting from the pound dropping at the moment. I would say move your goods into the UK fulfillment centers, such as Amazon FBA or any other local 3PL that might be available to you in the UK. And then you would need that UK VAT registration. The UK VAT registration is a kind of one-off thing. It can take about 8 weeks if you're a non-EU business. Now, once you have the VAT registration, it's a quarterly filing. You can choose quarterly or you can choose annually. So it's really not as painful as people might think. I think the most painful bit is probably getting that VAT registration. And once you get there, then it's just quite cyclical from there. So it should be quite straightforward and hopefully pain-free. And then once you're in the UK, you can start trading cross-border into Europe from there.
Perfect. Great advice. Zane is thanking the Dr. Watson. VAT is truly a complex topic. Umi Prime says, I was just able to join the broadcast. I apologize. I missed anything, if I missed anything. With our company established in UK, we want to send products to all European countries in the UK and cross-border. Our products are stored in UK and there is a wholesaler we work with in EU, and maybe we can store products there with wholesaler. And we have VAT number in Netherlands. Do we need to get VAT from different countries?
Yes. Yeah. This is great. And yeah, I'm going to use the information as much as I can here. So, okay, if you're going to be sending the goods, okay, let's start with your wholesaler. If you're selling B2B to the wholesaler, it's going to be an export from the UK and an import into the EU wherever your wholesaler is based. And for that B2B transaction, you should decide who's going to be that importer of record. If you did miss me, talk about importer records and the Incoterms. You just need to make sure that who's ever paying the VAT is responsible for that. So try to make your wholesaler responsible for importing the goods. Now, if you are going to store products with your wholesaler, if you're just storing them there and then sending them on, but under your own account, so say you have your own website and you are selling them on your own website and holding them with your wholesaler is kind of just a warehouse in that case, which means that you still need a VAT registration, whichever country your wholesaler is based in. If you have a VAT number in the Netherlands, maybe you want to just use a 3PL in the Netherlands where you can hold your inventory and sell cross-border from there. But the big answer here is whichever country you're holding your stock in for onward sale, you will need a local VAT registration in that country. So please make sure you get that in advance of selling. Now, because you're a UK business as well, you will, if you're selling B2C for those goods across the EU, once you pick the country where you're going to dispatch from, let's use the Netherlands for an example, you'd get a Netherlands OS number as well, the Union OS number, and that would be used for your cross-border transactions. I can just see all of your sales are through an online marketplace. So in that case, you still need the local VAT registration, whichever country you're holding your products in. Keep that in mind. Now, because you're a UK-based business, Amazon or whichever marketplace that you're selling on should be collecting the VAT for you. So as I mentioned before, make sure that you're including the local rate of VAT in your prices. So be prepared for the fluctuation between 17% and 27% wherever your customers are located. And the marketplace should be responsible to collect and remit that to the tax authorities. But you need to get that local VAT registration. And what happens is when you make a sale, let's say on Amazon, you will then record that transaction as exempt of VAT to Amazon on your local VAT return in the Netherlands, for example. So I hope that helps clarify.
Yeah, Uni Prime says, thank you for valuable support and information.
No problem.
Yanis says, if you ship from Amazon in the UK to other European countries, do you have to be VAT registered in those countries also?
No, this is a great one, Janice. So no, you don't need to be VAT registered in those countries. Now, since the UK has left the EU post-Brexit, there's now going to be seen as now as an export from the UK and an import into the EU. If you're selling only on Amazon, and like I mentioned before, we look at that consignment value, is it less than 150 euros? Are you shipping items that are maybe 30 pounds in value or 30 euros in value? Then you will be able to sell under Amazon's IOS number. As I mentioned, grab Amazon's IOS number in Seller Central. You'll use that IOS number on your import documents for those goods. And then it will, as the goods clear through customs, Amazon, or sorry, the EU customs authorities will look at the import documents, take down the IOS number and the value of the goods, and then let the goods go through. And then what happens is Amazon is collecting all the taxes on your transactions. And then when it comes to reporting on a monthly basis for Amazon, they will be reporting all these transactions, paying the money over to the tax authorities, and then the tax authorities split the money amongst themselves. So it's really Amazon's worry in this case, but you need to make sure you're using their IOS number. Otherwise, your goods are going to get stopped at the border. So Janice, you can sell cross-border. Just grab that IOS number as long as your goods are less than 150 euros.
Perfect. We will take a few more extra questions. I just wanted to mention, if you need help with VAT compliance, you will find the link below for SimplyVAT services. You can contact them, mention Orange Click, and they will help you to stay compliant in Europe, in Canada. And yeah, if you enjoy the answers and you get helpful information, don't forget to like the video as well and subscribe. Has a question. We are based in UK and selling in Germany. It's a non-European seller, company selling. And product is from a non-European manufacturer, say China. So do we need services of EU authorized person or EU importer?
Yes, yes, you do. So this is a really good one. Thank you for raising this. It's been a big problem for non-EU businesses trying to import the goods into Germany specifically. Now there is a customs rule where actually as a non-EU business trying to import goods into the EU, you actually do need an EU importer of record and what we call an indirect representative, for example. Now, these people are responsible for the goods getting into the EU country, such as Germany. Now, Germany is the main country where we've seen them really enforce the need for the EU importer. So that is the, if you're trying to import directly into Germany, it's definitely going to be tricky. You'll need what's called an indirect representative who take on that kind of responsibility of importing your goods into Germany. Now, there are other options that you have. There's things called limited fiscal representatives in Netherlands that you can route your goods through Netherlands and go without having a VAT registration in Netherlands and then move your goods into Germany. Now, this might be an answer for your business that where you can root it in and you don't need to worry about having that EU importer, because I know it's really tricky to find an indirect representative in Germany and they can be quite expensive too. So this limited fiscal rep might be an answer for you. And if you want to chat through that, I may have a contact. Well, I do have a contact for you. So feel free to reach out to me in the link below that that Augustus has mentioned, and I will be able to give you an answer for that as well, an introduction.
Perfect. Uniprime wants also to ask another question. How should we register for the VAT number we receive from any European country as IOS?
I'm not sure I understand the question, but if you're, so let's just, I'll try to interpret it. If you're trying to register for the IOS, and you guys mentioned that you're a UK-based business, you can choose where, if you're trying to register for the IOS scheme, you can choose where you want to register. That's completely up to you. Now, as a non-EU business, you do need to have what's called an intermediary. And an intermediary will be an EU-based business that is jointly liable for the VAT owed by your business. So essentially, if you don't pay the VAT, this intermediary will. They're held that jointly liable. Now, for example, we have at SimplyVAT, we have a business in Ireland, a subsidiary in Ireland, where we do all of our IOS registrations for our clients and act as the intermediary. And that's typically quite a kind of a easier country as well because they speak English. So if you want to get an IELTS registration, then we can help with that as you need an intermediary. So I hope I've answered the question for you, but I'm not sure if I interpreted it correctly.
All right, let me ask you a question about returns. So if how does VAT work with the product returns for Amazon sellers? So, you know, people buy and Amazon has this 30 days policy of returns.
Yeah, great question. So in terms, if again, you're responsible for, if you're responsible for the VAT collection and say you have to return a product, it's going to come on your VAT transaction report. It's a report that we as a tax agent would use to get all of your transactions. So we'll see all of your refunds, your sales, your fulfillment transfers, all from this specific report from Amazon. And the refunds in there are essentially kind of credited to your account. So say if you owe £100 in VAT that you've collected and you have a refund and there's £5 of VAT that you need to that refund back to the customer, you are paying that money back to the customer. However, the tax authorities are kind of crediting that to you in the amount that you've collected. So you would actually have to pay £95 over in your next VAT return rather than the £100 in your next VAT return. So it's essentially a credit kind of system, but you as the seller have to make sure that that full money goes back to the end customer when they request a refund, whether that's through your own website. Amazon will make sure that they transfer it back to you, but keep that in mind in your cash flow because Amazon is keeping track of it and giving that money back to the customer. It's going to come out of your pot.
All right. Let's see if we have more questions. I think it was from HM. She says, or he says, thanks, appreciate it. Jesus says, thank you for valuable information. Okay, there was another question from HM. Is there a difference between having services of EU authorized person and EU importer? If we do DDP from China to Germany, then who acts as EU importer?
So again, this would you would have to hire a business to do this. Now we don't do the we aren't the importer as a tax agent. I just have a network of people I can introduce you to hopefully help solve this problem for you. So yeah, but if you're doing DDP from China, you will need an EU going directly into Germany. You're going to need some sort of EU importer, an EU-based business to import your goods on your behalf. You can't do that as a non-EU business.
And Oni Prime is asking for a contact, how to get in touch with her when I call SimplyVAT and I want Irish iOS solution.
So yeah, if you want to get in touch with me directly, you can email me at alex@simplyvat.com. That's the best way. I will pick up your email first thing in the morning. I'm happy to help you with that. Otherwise, yeah, you can give us a call and just ask for Alex and I'll be on the other end. I'm the only Alex at the company. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
All right. I think we had a lot of things covered. Again, I wanted to mention that if you like this video, don't forget to click like below so you show to the world that you like it. And also if you need help with the VAT compliance, check the link for Simply VAT company below in the description. They are happy to help you with that. If you follow that link, you can I think fill up a form, or you can use a email address we just mentioned, alex@simplyvat.com. don't forget to mention orange click so that Alex knows you saw this video and decided to contact. So Uniprime says great, and I think there were more happy people in the chat. And thank you very much, Alex. And if you want, you can show again your slide where you have 4 or 5 services listed.
Oh yes, of course.
What you do, and maybe explain again so that people again get refreshed information about that.
Of course. So where can we help? Again, it's those local VAT registrations, ongoing compliance, the regular VAT returns, the union, non-union, and IOS registrations. We can help with all of that, and any consultancy as well. If you're having difficulty with any sort of VAT issues, we have a team of consultants that are on hand to help work through those complex solutions, or helping Amazing. To help in any way. Thank you so much for having me. And hopefully we'll tune back in about Canadian taxes as well. And I know, Janice, you'll be there watching. Looking forward to talking about it.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Alex. And good luck in your business. Bye-bye. And now I would like to invite you to watch another video with Alex, where she goes in more details how to be compliant and what do you need to know when you start or when you sell your Amazon products in European marketplaces. So a little bit more in details, check this out.